Welcome and thank you for joining the webinar today. I'm Amanda Jabro, the Director of Portfolio Management at Tricom. As an administrative and financial solutions provider to the staffing and consulting industry, it is our philosophy to be an active member of the staffing industry by staying abreast of the ever-changing marketplace. For that reason, Tricom was pleased to launch the Industry Insider webinar series designed to share our expert knowledge and resources with our fellow staffing industry colleagues. One of our core values is to build relationships and become a leading resource to staffing and consulting firms nationwide. Our presenter today is Tom Erb with Talon Resources. Talon Resources provides consulting, training, and coaching services to the staffing and recruiting industry, as well as workforce strategy, sales, and recruitment consulting to organizations of all sizes. Their services include strategic planning, sales structure development, including quota and compensation plans, sales and marketing strategy development, implementation and execution, recruitment strategy, operational analysis, and sales and recruitment training and coaching. With extensive experience in the flexible staffing, managed service, and recruiting industries, Talon Resources brings a broad and unique base of knowledge and creativity to the staffing industry. With a career spanning over 25 years, Tom Erb has established himself as one of the recruiting professionals' top subject matter experts. As an executive for two of the largest staffing recruiting companies, Tom worked with some of the most recognizable and well-respected companies in the world to help optimize their workforce strategy. As a consultant, trainer, and speaker, Tom has helped hundreds of organizations create and execute sales and recruiting strategies. In today's February Industry Insider webinar entitled Winning in the Staffing Sales Game in 2021, let's all agree to put the 2020 behind us and instead focus on how we can come out flying in the new year. In today's session, Tom, author of the industry best-selling book, Winning in the Staffing Sales Game, we'll talk about how to create and execute a repeatable sales process that works in the post-COVID era. Tom will discuss his philosophy behind and the importance of a structured, multi-touch sales strategy, how to truly differentiate yourself from your competition, and ultimately, how to land more and better new clients. In this session, we'll have an hour of proven, actionable steps that you can implement immediately that will have a profound impact on your business or career. With that, I will turn the floor over to Tom.
All right, thanks, Amanda. Thanks everybody for joining us. Thanks for taking an hour out of your busy days. So as Amanda talked about, what we're gonna discuss is what's changed. First of all, you know, we've obviously been through a lot of change in the last year. And sales has been part of that. And we've had a lot of things that have changed as far as how people buy, how people work. And because of that, we have to adapt our sales process. And so we're going to talk about how do we do that? And how do we leverage this? And how do we get ahead of our competition? Because quite frankly, in many cases, your competition is kind of at a loss of what to do. They're used to doing things a certain way, and you probably are too, and they're not adapting. And so there's a real opportunity for us to gain a competitive advantage coming out of here. And so let's go ahead and talk about this, if I can control this right. Wow, I did. Just real quick, so not meant to be a plug, but Amanda mentioned I did write Winning the Staffing Sales Game. And the reason why I bring this up and just show the picture is because when I wrote it and it came out about 3 years ago now, I thought, well, I'm going to have to really update this here pretty regularly, and we do. But what we found is that the concepts in it, what we've been talking about, has become even more relevant today than it maybe even was when I wrote the book a few years ago. And so that's a good thing for me because I don't have to go back and change a whole lot. But it also is, you know, there's a lot of reasons for it that what we talk about in the book works well, or in some cases even better now. And a lot of it has to do with the way that we're working and the way our prospects and our clients are working. So let's talk about how selling has changed. It's obviously changed quite a bit. Decision makers still, in many cases, aren't back in the office. In-person networking has completely gone away for now. The good news is that we're starting to see some movement there. There's a lot of pent-up need and pent-up desire to get back in person. I think most all of us on this call would feel that way. And we are starting to see organizations that are scheduling things. I've seen stuff scheduled. We've actually seen some in-person things here in the last month or two, and we're seeing more and more stuff scheduled out within the next few months. I'm on two boards of staffing associations, the Ohio Staffing, and then also the National Association of Personnel Services. In both cases, we are full steam ahead on our in-person conferences and talking to a lot more. I just had another staffing association reach out to me yesterday and ask if I would speak at their conference in August. So all of that stuff is good news, but we're not there yet. And because of that, we've had to adapt how we go about selling. And door-to-door cold calling, if any of you on the call are used to doing that, it has pretty much died for right now. Some people are trying it. They're not having much success. I wouldn't recommend it right now. I think it would be very poorly received in most markets, if not all markets. But some people are trying to get back out there. In-person cold calling will come back to some extent once all of this is over, because any time that people move away from a certain type of sales activity, others will see opportunity there. And so we'll be back to it to some extent, but I have a feeling that we'll see this chilling effect that will extend. It won't be the same as what it's been, and it probably won't be as well received. Not that it was ever greatly received. People weren't open arms with us cold calling in person. But it'll come back to some level. But so what's changed other than the obvious of what has changed? Well, fundamentally, the way that our prospects and clients and us work has changed significantly. And some of those things will revert back, but some of them are changed forever. And so just a few statistics. Statista came out with a study Q4 of last year, 83% of adults that were able to work from home during COVID opted to do so. So 4 out of 5 are doing that, and many continue to do that. Mercer did a study that showed that 94% of employers say the productivity was not reduced by a move to remote work. Now, this was done earlier in the crisis when people were going back. It was kind of novelty. My guess is that that number would not hold up today. I just know from my own experience with remote work and with having employees who are remote work that it is difficult for that productivity level to stay at the same. That they probably got a lot of employers at a honeymoon level. Nonetheless, we have been able to see that you can still maintain a high level of productivity, and in some cases, an actually higher level of productivity when people are working from home. So that means that there's going to be more of a tendency to let people do that moving forward. 77% use video conferencing at least once a week, and 1 in 3 use it every single day. I know I use it every day. Probably most of you do it as well. 83% of employers will put more flexible work policies in place after COVID. We're seeing this both on the client side, but we're also seeing this. I have a recruiting division with my company. We recruit for staffing companies, internal positions. We're seeing significantly more demand on the candidate side to have remote work options. And so it's going to be partly forced by the candidate pool and partly by the clients who are seeing that there are cost benefits to it and other types of benefits. And 70% of workers would prefer to telecommute after COVID. We're still seeing those numbers hold true. So what does that mean to us from a sales standpoint? Well, it changes our sales approach, and it changes it in a few different ways. The first is that prospects are now even harder in many cases to get in front of through traditional sales activities because they're not at their desk. They're not in the office 5 days a week. And even when we get back to people going back into the office, it's quite likely that it will be some sort of a hybrid for many people. I've talked to many, many employers that are talking about scaling down the size of their operations because they're going to allow people to work home at least partly, maybe 2 or 3 days a week. And then they'll do more of like a hoteling where people are sharing spaces and they're actually reserving space as opposed to this is my desk 5 days a week, this is my office 5 days a week. And because of that, it's going to be harder consistently to get in front of people through traditional sales methods. Decision makers have been shifting to more informational buying for years now, but there's been a significant shift. They're all the way there. We are all the way there because we're all buyers. And we're all towards that informational buying, which means we're going out onto the internet, we're researching, we're investigating, we're looking into social media, we're asking peers and friends and others, and even total strangers of what they think about companies and about products and services before they make decisions. With their mailings, we're seeing make a comeback. Actual live snail mail letters, we're seeing a better response to those than ever before. And it's because people are informational buying, and in many cases, they're at home. And most companies have figured out how to get the mail to them now, maybe delayed a little bit, but they're now figuring out how to do that because they've been doing it for so long. Marketing is becoming even more interwoven with sales to the point where it's almost indistinguishable. And so we need to take that into consideration. We can't have sales over here and marketing over here. And sales activities moving forward are going to need to be more purposeful. They're going to need to be more targeted, and we're going to need to have consistency to them. We're going to have repetition that works. Daniel Pink wrote a book about a year and a half, maybe 2 years ago now, called To Sell Is Human. And in it, he talks about this whole shift to the informational buyer and how that impacts sales. And one of the quotes that he has in the book is that the balance of power has shifted, and how we've moved from a world of caveat emptor, which is buyer beware, we've all heard that, to one of caveat venditor, seller beware, where honesty, fairness, and transparency are often the only viable path. What it means is that now we can't just call in and say, hey, we're a great staffing company, you should use us. It's now we're calling in saying, hey, we're a great staffing company, and they're going out and investigating us and making sure that that's the case. And if that's the case, we need to have that proof to back it up. And it's better they get it from us than it is that they go out and they find it from other sources, because we obviously have more control over what they get from us. So first thing we need to do is adapt to this informed buyer. And we do it through a variety of ways. The first thing is to provide proof. And that is proof of what we say makes us different, what we say makes us better is true. Because as a salesperson, I can talk about how great I am, but a prospect is going to be somewhat skeptical of that, because my whole purpose is to get them to buy from me. So they're obviously naturally going to be somewhat skeptical of me or any other salesperson that talks about how great they are. Also, it's quite likely if they've been doing it for any length of time that some other salesperson talked about how great they were and how great their company was, and it didn't turn out to be that way, right? We've all had that. So what we need to do is instead provide them proof that what we're saying is true, and hey, don't believe me, believe this other proof, which is either quantitative, third party, or is coming from clients or from candidates or both. And so some of the ways that we do that is we create content. We create blogs and articles and ebooks and different types of content that we can provide to them that reinforces that we are experts at what we say we are, and maybe give examples, case studies, things like that. Our website needs to reinforce what our messaging is. So because we know that if somebody has any interest in us at all, they do two things. They go and check out the website, and they go and check out the LinkedIn profile of the person reaching out to them. We know that because when we start to do a lot of sales activity, we can actually see the number of profile views on LinkedIn skyrocket. And so we want to make sure that we are reinforcing what we say everywhere that they're going to go. And those are going to be website. It's going to be to our on-site or our online reputation. So Google and Facebook and Indeed and Glassdoor and all of those different places. And then it's going to be to social media. And so we want to make sure that it's consistent and it represents us the way that it's supposed to. The other thing that we're seeing too is video is becoming a great way to connect with people. If we can't see them in person, video is the second best thing. We're living it right now as I speak. And so what we've seen where there's a lot of success in a couple of different areas, one is embedding video in emails. And not just having a link to a video, hey, here's a video I did for you, but actually having a screenshot of that video with an embedded link in it so that they click on it, it goes to it. There are lots of different systems that do this. One of the ones I use, which is free, is Vimeo Record, but there's lots of other ones that do that too. There's Vidly and also all sorts of different ones. Video appointments are another great way for us to kind of bridge that gap between seeing them in person and talking to them on the phone. We can kind of do the next best thing and we can have a video appointments. We're seeing more video appointments than ever before. And then we also can use alternative communication methods. I mentioned snail mail earlier. Getting mail out to something tangible that they can look at has proven to be more valuable than ever. And then obviously social media. We're seeing people really shift to social media. They have been for the last 8 or 9 months to kind of fill that void of networking. And I know from my own personal experience, a year ago, if I posted something onto LinkedIn, I would be lucky to get 600-700 views. I can post that same content now and I'll get 3,000 or 4,000 views. And it's not because I'm posting anything better there. It's not because my number of followers or connections has gone up significantly. It's because people are much more active on LinkedIn and Facebook groups and those types of places than they ever have been before. So it brings us to the winning the staffing sales game approach. And I always talk about the analogy that sales is a game of chess, not war. And what I mean by that is that if we think about the game of war, it is a card game where you have two people playing, you have two decks or you split a deck in half, and both sides slap down a card and whoever has the high card wins. Very transactional, very much win-loss. I win this round, you win this round. There's no strategy to it. There's no building off of what we've done before. It's just very much transactional. That's how most people approach sales. And I can prove that to you. I can't ask you all questions about this, but you can answer it to yourself. Is when I ask people, what are you trying to, what's your objective when you're trying to make a cold call for the first time, when you're making a phone call to a new prospect? The number one response I get is, I'm trying to get an appointment, okay? Number two response I get is, I'm trying to get an order. Number three is, I'm trying to get some information, or I'm trying to build rapport, or all of these different things, which are all good, but they all require one thing, is that I talk to a live person. And we know through data, there was a study done a few years ago that showed that the ratio of voicemails to live connects was 22-1. Our own numbers show that it's closer to 30-1 now, sometimes even greater. So 29 out of 30 times, we're gonna fail in what our objective is because we didn't even get a live person on the phone. Nobody in all the times I've asked that question has ever responded, I wanna leave a compelling voicemail. Nobody. But 29 times out of 30, that's what we're gonna be faced with. If we approach sales as more of a game of chess, we approach it strategically. We know that we can't win in one move. We know that one move early on builds on others, and or others build on it. And we very early can determine whether or not we're going to be successful or not. What we do now is going to have a positive or a negative impact on what we do 3 or 4 moves down the road. And it's the same with sales. We need to look at it more as a process. I need to look at when I make that phone call, my goal is to leave a compelling voicemail that positions me well for the next step. Because I know 29 out of 30 times, I'm going to get a voicemail. that 1 out of 30 times, I'm going to be prepared for that too. But I know 29 times out of 30, which is, you know, 90 some percent of the time, I'm going to have to leave a voicemail. So let's go ahead and prepare for that and be ready for it. So what we have in our process is a simple 6-step structured process. And it is designed to hit people different ways. It is a multi-touch, multi-step process. It's also not rocket science. It's it is fundamental sales, but it's put into a structure that is repeatable, consistent, and effective. And it starts with the green piece up at the top. We identify what we call suspect companies and contacts. We then, step two is to implement a 10-week sales contact schedule. Over the course of 10 weeks, we touch them 12 times. And then as we're going through that process, we are qualifying or disqualifying those suspects. We're qualifying them into prospects or into targets. And I'll talk about that a little more here in a second. Or we are disqualifying them out. Either way, we're shrinking down our universe, and we are basically getting more information about our market. We are finding out who are our best few. We are giving ourselves more visibility. We are allowing people in our market to know that we exist and what is different about us, all of those things. Then as we go through and we start to have targets, targets mean we're going to have opportunities that we're going to put into our sales pipeline. We then work the sales pipeline through the sales process, which are the sales stages. And then we close them out as wins and losses, and we're constantly replenishing. So we're constantly feeding new suspects into this process so that we don't go through that roller coaster effect that most salespeople do, which is we have, you know, we'll do a bunch of prospecting and we run it through the sales process. We get it all the way through. We win a few of them, we lose a few of them, and then we have to start from scratch and we start prospecting again. And what happens is then our gross profit dollars reflect that as well. Our commissions reflect that as well. And we go through this roller coaster that most salespeople go through. If we're constantly feeding it and paying attention to it, then we don't have that issue and we have more consistent performance. The first thing we want to do is define what our ideal client is. And I see that this is a challenge for a lot of people. Is we kind of run out there and just start going after companies. And we don't really think about who is our ideal client. Who do we do the best servicing? Where do we have some expertise that we can leverage? Where do we have a database that we can leverage? Who, you know, if we have salespeople that are going out and just trying to get any kind of business that we have, and then we have the recruiting team that is actually focused and is successful with certain types of positions, if those don't line up, we're not going to have success. And so we need to identify that. And what we do is we take a look at what company types, what industries, what professions. We look at what's the size of the company that we go after. We don't want to go after a bunch of companies that have 10 people in them. And it's not that we can't be successful with them. The problem is there's way too many for us to effectively go after, and the opportunities are way too small. And what I found is in most industries, and it varies based on what you do, but typically we're looking somewhere in that 50 employee up to about 1,000 employee is kind of a sweet spot. And some of you may be in particular niches where you go higher or where you're even more specifically, but my recommendation is that you start more narrow. You can always expand out. So maybe you say, you know what, we do really well with companies between 200 to 1,000. And once I've exhausted those, then I'll go down maybe to 50 and I'll go up to 5,000. By the way, I use these numbers because they happen to be, not coincidentally, the same numbers that you do searches on in LinkedIn Sales Navigator. And so that's where we go. Who do we go after in organizationally? We need to know who are the most likely people in the organization for us to work with. So take a look at past experience. Odds are you probably in most cases end up in HR, talent acquisition, hiring managers, executives, depending on the size of the organization. And you know, you got to take that into consideration as well. You don't want to go after a company that has 10,000 employees and try and go after the CEO. But a company that has 200 employees, the CEO might be the right person. So we need to take that into consideration as well. And then seniority level. And I always recommend going at least at a director level or above, unless it's a smaller company where the highest level person has a manager title, like an HR manager of a warehouse or something like that. But in most cases, we're looking at director level, VP level, C level to go after. Otherwise, we're swimming upstream in many cases, or we're stuck at a lower level. We don't want to be stuck at a generalist level or something like that. Talk about focused prospecting. So I mentioned suspects, prospects, and targets earlier. Suspects, prospects, and targets are basically a breakdown of what prospects are to most people. A suspect is a prospect that we haven't qualified yet. They meet that ideal client profile, but we have not talked to anybody there, or we haven't talked to anybody there for a long time. And so we suspect that they meet the profile, but we need to qualify them. So that's what we start with in the process. Once we've done that, then they become a prospect. So typically we know they use, we've talked to somebody, or we know they have the potential to use, they've used in the past, or they're thinking about using or whatever. But we don't have an opportunity to do business with them in the near future. In the near future, you typically look at about 90 days. Do we think we can be doing business with them for about 90 days? The reason why I picked that is because the sales life cycle in staffing for more of your retail, small to mid-size business is typically somewhere around 60 to 90 days. So you go too much past that and you tend to lose a lot of deals to just inactivity and that kind of stuff. Larger deals have longer sales cycles, but we take 90 days for most of it. So prospects are companies or contacts that use staffing but are not currently open to talking to us about it. Targets are the prospects that are open to talking to us. So we've had a conversation with them and there is a door opening, even if it's just slight, the door has opened. And so they're open to us. So if you can look at this a different way too, you can look at suspects cold, prospects warm, targets is hot. It's also a good way to manage your time. Because you want to spend more time with your targets than you do your prospects, and more time with your prospects than you do your suspects, because they're cold, warm, and hot. General rule of thumb also is a nice balanced prospect list would have somewhere around 300 suspects, 100 prospects, and about 20 targets. These numbers are never going to be exact because somebody who's been in a market for 10 years is going to have a lot more prospects than somebody who's starting out day one. They're going to have almost no prospects or very few unless they're fed those prospects. How do we identify suspects? Well, there's lots of different ways to do it, but the quickest way is to search for jobs. We are in one of the only industries I can think of where our prospects actually advertise they might need our help. And they do that through posting jobs. And the best ones to look at are the aggregators, Google Jobs, Indeed, LinkedIn Jobs. Because they come from a variety of sources, and I also find that they have good search results, better search results than some others. What you do is you search for those jobs, you set up an email reminder, you have it emailed to you on a daily or a weekly basis, however frequently you want to, and then typically I'll sit on those for a little bit of time because somebody who posted a job yesterday is still at their highest level of hope that they're going to find the perfect person to apply to the job. We want to get them after a week or two when they've been frustrated by the applicant flow. Then we go to LinkedIn. We identify who the most likely contacts are. With larger companies, it's good to spread a little bit wider a net. It's not unusual to have half a dozen or even more people we're reaching out to within an organization. We target HR, talent acquisition, operations, specific departments if you're in IT or accounting or engineering or whatever it might be. And then we go and find contact information. There are some ones that are relatively inexpensive, like Hunter.io, ZapInfo, Lucia, Contact Out. And then there's other ones that are, you can go and you can buy the lists. You can do ZoomInfo and Hoovers and Seamless AI. And there's a variety of different ones that you can do. So I get people who ask me questions about what's the difference between somebody who's successful in sales and somebody who struggles. And over the course of time, I say, you know, it really kind of goes into this acronym MVP. But even before we get to the acronym, there has to be a baseline. There has to be a foundation. Fundamental characteristics of a salesperson need to exist. And so if we look down at that, we call it the EQ line. It's the emotional quotient, emotional intelligence. Fundamentally, and just at a base level, salespeople need to be likable, credible, and coachable. They need to be likable and credible in order to have opportunities to consistently work with contacts and to be considered and to close deals. But they also need to be coachable so that they can continue to learn, because sales changes. So we've talked about that, how much sales has changed in the last year. It's always changing. So you need to have somebody who's coachable, who's willing to learn and willing to adapt and willing to change. If we have that base level, then we get into the M of MVP, which is messaging. We have to sound different than other staffing companies. Almost all staffing companies sound the same. And so we need to have messaging that resonates. We need to have truly differentiating characteristics that the prospects perceive as having value. On the V level, we have to have enough volume and we have to have enough variety to be able to have success. When I go and I work with companies and I work with their sales reps, one of the first things I do is talk about volume of activity. How many sales activities do you do a week? And when I first start talking to people, almost always they say about 100 activities a week, somewhere around there. I would say 90% of the time they say 100 activities. When we start to dig into the actual numbers that are in the system, it's usually closer to 30 to 40. That's not enough activity. Even 100 activities is not enough activity for a full-time sales rep. So we need to have enough volume to allow ourselves a chance to be successful, because activities lead to appointments. Appointments lead to opportunities in the pipeline, and opportunities in the pipeline lead to sales and lead to gross profit dollars. We also want to have variety, because not everybody communicates the same. There are some people that communicate much better via phone. There are others that communicate much better via social media or through email or through other methods. And so we want to have that volume or that variety. And then the last one is persistence. So not only do we want to have volume, enough activities, but we want to do it enough times with each of our suspects and our prospects to give ourselves a chance for them to make a decision. So we need to be persistent enough to do that. That brings us to our 10-week process. So we have developed over the course of time 12 touches over 10 weeks. And you can see these are the 10 weeks. If you think about 10 weeks, that's 2.5 months. A lot can happen with that prospect in 2.5 months. Most of us are calling 2 or 3 times and then we kind of give up and move on. Either we get bored or we have this misconception that, well, they must not have a need because they're not responding to me. And yet we've only talked to them or reached out to them even 2 or 3 times. So we need to reach out to them enough times. So this forces salespeople to reach out enough times over a sustained period of time to let good things happen, okay? And we started out with this letter, this value prop mailing. And it talks about how great we are. Here's what makes us different. Here's why our clients work with us. And here's the benefits that we have, that they have for working with us. And here's some additional proof. And we get that to them in a physical form right from the beginning. We've done it with the mailing and we've done it without. And we have specific and significant data that shows with the letter, it works significantly better. Week two, we reach out to them 3 times. We follow up on the letter with an email. We then tell them, hey, I'm going to follow up and call you tomorrow between this time and this time. And then when we call them between that time and that time, we say, I'm going to follow up with an email. I'm going to see if I can get on your calendar for 10 minutes. We're not asking for an hour-long appointment. We don't want a long commitment. We're asking specifically for a short commitment. And then we follow up with them with an email, and typically we'll have some sort of content in there, like a candidate skill market. Hey, here's somebody that we're working with right now. I thought you might have some interest in them. dangling that carrot in front of them that has value. And then we alternate between phone calls and emails that have some sort of content, and we vary these, and this is all custom to whatever your expertise is and whatever types of information that you have. So we do that over the course of 10 weeks. And then in week 10, we say, hey, we're going to back off. A lot of us get these backing off emails. It's not anything new. But what people make the mistake of is doing the backing off email too quick. After two or three attempts, they do a backing off email, or they do the backing off email in a way that actually turns off the prospect. It's kind of like, well, I've been reaching out to you for several weeks and you haven't responded, so I'm just going to stop reaching out to you, right? As if the prospect had some sort of obligation to respond to them. So we have the backing off email where it's after 12 touches, or it is the 12th touch. And so we've kind of earned that ability to do it. They've gotten used to us. And it also creates this psychological phenomena called reactance. And reactance is the act of taking an option away from somebody. As human beings, we don't like to have our options taken away from us, even if it's just a sales rep saying, I'm going to stop reaching out to you. And so we do see that in many cases, in week 10, we'll get a response to that backing off email. So that's the process real quick. We've had this process now for several years. And so this is called winning the staffing sales game in 2021. Some of the things that we've done to really benefit from new technology is through having those video appointments. It's through embedding that video technology. In many cases, we've started to put an embedded video in week two, week four, and down the line, we've put them into that cadence. And we're having huge response from that. So it's been really successful for us to do that. Also, we have all sorts of different sales process automations and workflows that we can utilize. And we're seeing that a lot more with a lot of our clients. We're having success where we don't have to send off those emails. We can have it actually automated. We can create, with some of these systems, we can utilize artificial intelligence. So based on how they respond to us, or based on how we interact, it can actually put them into different types of workflows. And so this is just an example of a sales process automation, but there's lots of different ones that do this. There's ones that are in your applicant tracking system. There are some applicant tracking systems that have native functionality like Tracker RMS. There are others that have ATS integrations with like HereFish and Sense. There are standalone CRMs that have this automation like Pipedrive and Zoho. And then there's also standalone marketing automation like HubSpot and MailChimp that have these different types of workflows. And we're seeing tremendous time savings from utilizing these. And we can reach out to many more people because of this. And so it's a great way for us to be able to automate the process and just be more efficient and more effective in the results. Last thing I want to talk about just real quick is just increasing your digital presence. And because, as I mentioned before, when we do start to do lots of activity, people do start to research us. And we know that. We've got the data on it. And so we can do it through all sorts of different ways. We can provide them with content like we talked about. And those are blogs, videos, podcasts. Podcasts are great. We can be a resource. We want to make sure our website is up to date and that it has good search engine optimization, that we're showing up on the front page, ideally, of Google when they're doing searches on us, and that it reinforces our sales messaging. We don't want to be saying one thing in the sales process and then our website says a completely different thing or kind of a different thing. Doing LinkedIn status updates, following people, liking them, commenting. So you can put people through this process and then you go on to LinkedIn. You don't have to send them an invite to connect to follow them. You can actually go and just follow them and then they'll start to show up into your into your feed. And as they do, you can start to like and comment and share things that they're doing so that you get on their radar more and more. It's just another touch point to do that. And then Facebook, we've seen over the last couple of years that most LinkedIn groups have migrated over to Facebook. And it just seems to be a more interactive platform. LinkedIn, with Microsoft acquiring them a couple of years ago, put a lot of restrictions on what you could do in LinkedIn groups. And so now we're seeing those groups showing up and being really robust and interactive on Facebook instead. So you want to make sure that you join and you participate in those so that you have some visibility there. Here's some ways that some prospects respond. We had this just happen just a few weeks ago where we had a prospect respond, "Wow, your timing's crazy. I just sent your letter to my team and also let them know that I appreciate the formal mailing. If this was spam mail and my name wasn't handwritten," because we handwrite the address on the envelope, "I would not have even opened it. I also appreciate not being harassed on the phone. We get so many recruiter calls and our company does not often use recruiting companies. However we do, I will keep your company in mind in the future. I'm impressed with this form of contact." That came from an HR director that was on the process. There are a ton of these other ones as well. We got one not too long ago where the sales rep sent the letter, then followed up the next week with the prospect, reached out and said, "I sent you a letter. Not sure if you received it yet. Here's a quick recap. I'm going to call you tomorrow." The prospect, the VP of operations, responded back to her in an email and just said, "Thanks, but we don't have a need right now." That was it. Just a blow off email. 3 hours later, in between, he had gotten the letter that she had said, and he got it in the mail. He responded back to her and said, "I just got your letter. I can't tell you how impressed I am with this. You've taken this extra effort to do this," and he completely re-engaged her on the conversation. So he went from a blow-off email 3 hours earlier to going out of his way to compliment her and re-engage her in the discussion. Excuse me. So we see a lot of that. We're seeing a lot of this type of interaction going on right now, and a lot of it has to do with people are buying different. We talked about that at the beginning. They're working differently and they're buying differently. So I just want to close it up, and we've got, you know, some time for questions. We'd love to take some questions from you. But how our clients and prospects are working and how they're buying is changing and has changed forever. Our sales approach must adapt. We need a more structured, targeted, multi-pronged sales process. We need to leverage technology like never before to scale our activities. And we want to increase our digital presence to support and benefit from this new informational buyer. So that's my presentation. I'm going to open it up. Amanda, if we want to maybe take some questions, I'll be happy to answer them.
Certainly. So please go ahead and enter your question either in the chat or the Q&A feature. And I'll read them off, and Tom will be happy to address those sales questions that you have. And as people are thinking, just to kind of get us started, tell us a little bit about your experience with working with staffing industries and maybe some of the biggest struggles that they have that they could take away from today's session.
Yeah, I think the biggest challenge I see consistently is not enough activity. And when there is activity, it's generic activity. The messaging has not been thought through, and is too similar to what other staffing companies are saying. Everybody's out there talking about quality. Oh, it's the quality of our placements. It's the quality of our service, or it's things like we care more, and those are all good things. But the problem is that everybody else is saying the same thing too. And your absolute worst competitors are out there saying their quality is better. And so it just really kind of worn down that messaging. So it's two things. It's the having enough sales activity, And we have found that somewhere around 150 or so activities is that sweet spot for a dedicated full-time sales rep. And when I talk about sales activities, we're really talking about phone calls, either voicemails or live connects, email conversations, which means that there's a response from the person that we're sending an email to. We can send out thousands of emails in a couple of minutes. So I don't count emails as activities, but I also don't want to discount that different people communicate differently. So if we are able to get a response via email, then I do want to count that as an activity, or if we're having an interaction with them via email or text or social media. And then the last thing that I count as an activity is networking conversation. So if we're at a networking event, whether that's virtual or in person, once we get to do that again, and we have 8 conversations there, that's 8 activities. So we find that having about 150 activities is about the right number for a full-time sales rep. About 3 or 4 appointments a week that are really good appointments is ideal. We don't need to have 12 appointments a week. And then that all leads into, opportunities that we're working through our pipeline stages, and then ultimately gross profit, the results. So looks like a couple of questions. I'll go ahead and read them off, Amanda. I can do that. I see them here.
Go ahead.
What are your thoughts on recruiters, sourcers also doing sales since they're well-versed using LinkedIn? Okay. We do behavioral assessments. We've been doing behavioral assessments for 10 years. We partner with a company that does it. We've run over 1,000 recruiting and salespeople through these behavioral assessments. I can tell you without hesitation that recruiters and salespeople, for the most part, have different skill sets and have different behavioral traits, very specific behavioral traits. That's not to say that you can't from time to time have recruiters that are really good recruiters and really good salespeople and vice versa. What I'm saying is the vast majority of people will tend to go one way or the other. So I am not a big believer in recruiters doing sales. The other reason why is because sales is hard enough when it's your full-time job, but to also be split and to do it part-time, it's very difficult to have consistent results that are enough to move the needle. I will add a caveat to that there are certain sales activities that can be done from the desk, such as skill marketing. I believe that just about anybody can do skill marketing. If you have a really great candidate, that you can reach out and present those candidates to prospects and clients. But to pick up the phone and make cold calls to prospects, it's very, very difficult to do, not being a dedicated salesperson. The next one is how to reach decision makers at home with mobile numbers. The usual way of calling the gatekeeper has not been effective due to most decision makers do not have direct transfers. That's not been our experience. Our experience has been they've had 9 months to figure this out, 12 months to figure this out. In most cases, we are seeing that numbers are now getting forwarded onto it. I do think that the calling people on their mobile is still a gray area. I think it's one of those areas where it's interesting because I've been working with a lot of sales reps on this. And I had one sales rep that wanted to start trying to call mobile numbers. And he was uncertain about how that would be received. And I said, you know what, just be honest with him. Call him and go, hey, listen, I don't know if you consider this appropriate or not. This is kind of gray area, but I didn't know how else to reach you. And he did that for one day, and he ended up getting a couple of appointments out of it. He ended up having a lot of good conversations because he did get more live connects, actually. And so I do think that's a great way to do it. It is harder to get those mobile numbers. I would say you take a look again at some of the ways that we talked about before, which is through Lucia and contact out Zap Info. Sometimes you will get those from it. People, PIPL is another way to sometimes get those mobile numbers. Seamless AI, Zoom Info, some of the others also do have some mobile numbers as well. It is harder to get hold of. You got to be a little bit careful of it, or I would start with a caveat where I'm going, hey, I'm not sure if I don't mean to be off limits here, because many times they'll give you a pass on that. Okay. I see a question up here, and Amanda, if I'm missing some of them, let me know, because I'm looking at both of them. Our difficulty is customers using MSPs forcing us to not be able to communicate directly with the hiring manager. Yep, you're right. So there's two different ways, a couple of different ways you can go about MSPs. MSPs are just a fact of life with us, particularly if you're in IT or healthcare. Other verticals don't deal with them as much, but still run across them quite a bit. There's all different types of MSPs, everything from the complete black hole, which is horrible and miserable to deal with, all the way to the other side where they kind of, they manage it, but they let you still have conversations, and there's a lot of flexibility around pricing and things like that. There's not as many that do that. And then there's everything in between. So you have to just kind of make a determination. I don't lump everything, every MSP together. There are good MSPs out there. The benefit to going with an MSP is that if you get in with the right one, the smart MSPs will take you all across the country if you want to go with them. They will introduce you, because if you do a really good job with them, and if you fill a need for them, either with a specific skill set specialization that you have, or maybe you have a set aside status like disabled veteran or MBE or something like that, and you can show them that you can consistently perform for them, they will, and you develop relationships with those MSP managers, they can take you all over the country. And we've seen a lot of our clients explode because they've gotten in with some good MSPs. So don't just lump them all into one area. You have to realize that with MSPs, in a lot of cases, they're going to be, their job is to be the go-between for good or bad. And you need to either decide that you're going to play in that game and look for the good ones, or you're going to try and go around them as much as possible. If that's the case, the best way to do that is to move down on the company size, because the lower the company size, the less likely they are to use MSPs. In IT and healthcare, anything above certainly 5,000 employees is probably going to be under an MSP, and even 1,000 employees, many of them are going to be. So those are the only questions that I see, Amanda, unless there's other questions anybody wants to post.
Nope.
I'll be happy to answer them.
Yep. So you have covered all the questions that have come in so far. Again, if you have any questions, feel free to send it in now, or if you want to talk to Tom one-on-one, send him specific information about your questions, you can do so by contacting him. His information is on the screen. So with that, unless you have any other final thoughts, we can close today's session out.
Just the only thing I would add is that if I don't know if you are giving them a copy of the presentation, but if anybody wants a copy of the presentation, feel free to shoot me an email or send me an invite to connect on LinkedIn, and just reference that you saw me on this. Would love to connect with everybody on LinkedIn if I'm not already connected with you. But best of luck to everybody. Good luck. And if you have any questions or any additional follow-up, feel free to reach out.
Wonderful. Thanks so much, Tom. As always, it's great to have you on our webinar sessions. Such wonderful information regarding sales. We will have a recording of this webinar posted on our website at tricom.com. It'll be out on our YouTube page, so feel free to Take a look at it there, share it amongst your colleagues, share on social media, and we hope that you join us again for our next webinar presentation. Have a great afternoon, everyone.
Thank you.